Gauss-Jordan elimination. So that is the topic of the day. In Gaussian elimination, we got the row echelon form, which was an upper triangular matrix. And in order to be able to solve the system of linear equations represented by the matrix A, you had to do back substitution. But if you think about it, back substitution also is an elementary row operation. It's a scaling of a row and then subtracting it from the rows above. What the RREF gave you, the upper triangular matrix gave you, the number of pivots and the product of the diagonal elements would give you the determinant if A was a square matrix. Now, back substitution, as I said, is an ERO. If you go ahead and perform the back substitution also starting from the RREF, that would be the Gauss-Jordan elimination. So Gauss-Jordan elimination is the same as Gaussian elimination plus the back substitution so that you actually get the solution in the matrix form. So we have our favorite equations, x plus y equal to 5, x minus y equal to 1. How we did the Gaussian elimination is to get the augmented matrix x plus y equal to 5, x minus y equal to 1, and then subtract row 1 from row 2 to kill this leading non-zero in the second row. Okay, so the elementary operation was the first row of the RREF of the augmented matrix is the same as the first row of the augmented matrix, which means I took 1 of the first row and 0 of the second row. The second row, I took minus 1 of the first row and 1 of the second row. That summation is basically subtracting the first row from the second row. It is the first elementary operation, we might call that E1. Then, in order to do the Gauss-Jordan elimination, I have to do two more things. I want to make sure that the pivots are all 1, which is easy to do by scaling. So I have a pivot row here that had minus 2 in the pivot position. I just scale it by 1 over minus 2. Just divide by minus 2. That is a second operation here. The first row, because the pivot was already 1, I didn't have to do anything. So first row is the first row plus 0 of the second row. Second row, 0 of the first row plus minus half of the second row. So I get 1 there. So that is one objective of Gauss-Jordan elimination done. I have the pivots all 1 now. Now the second objective is to get rid of all the elements above the pivot in any column. So using the pivot here, I can get rid of all the elements above it. Would I do it? I just have to subtract from the first row, the second row. Then 1 will subtract away from 1 here. So this 1 will become 0. Something will happen here, but nothing will happen to the first pivot because everything below that is 0 anyway. Subtracting second row from the first row, that is the third elementary operation. The first row becomes first row minus 1 times the second row. The second row, nothing happens to it. 0 times the first row plus 1 times the second row. So the non-pivot became 0. So those are the two things I want to do. Now, if you look at the matrix here after Gauss-Jordan elimination, and if you look at just the coefficient part, what do you see? It's the identity matrix. So the objective of Gauss-Jordan elimination is try to get the identity matrix in the coefficient part. If you cannot get the identity matrix, get as close to it as possible. If you can get to the identity matrix, then the augmented matrix becomes identity matrix augmented by some numbers, some constants. And what are the constants now? What does this augmented matrix actually say in terms of equations? This is my augmented matrix, the output of Gauss-Jordan elimination, which we call reduced row echelon form. This is the same as writing the identity matrix times the x vector is equal to whatever you see in the augmented part, 3, 2. Now I just carry out the multiplication. What does it say? It's 1 times x plus 0 times y. So the top row basically just says x equal to 3. The bottom row is 0 times x plus 1 times y. That just says y is equal to 2. What we did essentially was back substitution. It's a codification of back substitution in terms of elementary operation. So the upper triangular matrix in the row echelon form is the output of a Gaussian elimination. So this upper triangular matrix here, the coefficient part will become the identity matrix, or as close to the identity matrix as possible. So Gauss-Jordan elimination gives you reduced row echelon form, or RREF, which is RREF with a couple of more properties. RREF, zero rows will have to be at the bottom of the matrix, and the pivot in any row has to be to the right of the pivots in the rows above. Now the Gauss-Jordan, starting from the RREF, it adds a couple of more properties. It scales the pivot rows by the pivot value, divided by the pivot value, so that you get a 1 in the pivot positions. Then it goes ahead one more step, uses the pivot value in any row to get rid of the elements above the pivot. So just subtract appropriate multiples of that row from the rows above. So it actually, the Gaussian elimination, it goes down first and then it goes back up to get rid of all the elements above each pivot, which is basically back substitution. Now, RREF is not unique. You perform the Gaussian elimination. Since you have the freedom of swapping any two rows, you might get different row echelon form for the same matrix. But RREF, on the other hand, is you need for a matrix. There's only one RREF given the matrix. So that's the reason why people like to call it a canonical form, because it's a unique form. Now let's talk about the algorithm, how it actually does it. So one way of doing it would be to run the Gaussian elimination first to get the RREF, then start from the RREF and do one more loop, take each pivot row and scale it by 1 over pivot to make the pivots unity, and then loop over the rows above and subtract away the appropriate multiple of the pivot row to get rid of all the elements above. That is the second step. So this is Gaussian elimination is one loop. This is the second loop on top of it. If the RREF of some matrix turns out to be the identity matrix and you have some values in the constants column, the augmented column, then that is basically saying that XYZ is equal to 1, 2, 3, because identity multiplying any vector just gives you that vector back. That also means one more thing. If you can find a unique solution, then the RREF will always have an identity matrix standing here. That means all equations with the same number of equations and same number of variables, all of them will have a coefficient part reduced to the identity matrix for all of them. So all non-singular invertible matrices will row reduce to the identity matrix. Later on, we will call that row equivalent. So all the non-singular matrices are row equivalent to the identity matrix, and they are also column equivalent to an identity matrix. That's just a name. What it means is that all non-singular matrices will reduce to the identity matrix, because all non-singular matrices can be inverted. So the moment you have I augmented by a B prime, then X equal to B prime, all in vector lingo, is the solution. Now let's look at the shapes of different matrices and some examples. So if a square matrix is full rank, then that means the rank is the same as the number of rows or number of columns, and all the rows and columns are linearly independent, obviously, and all the rows will end up having pivots because they're all linearly independent, and they can be scaled so that you get ones there. You can use the one in the pivot column now to get rid of the stuff above it, which means you can always reduce it to the identity matrix. So all invertible, non-singular, full rank matrices will row reduce to the identity matrix of the same size. But on the other hand, if it is rank deficient, it's a bit more complicated. So rank R is less than N now. So what you will get will be R rows and columns that are independent, which will give R non-zero pivot rows, which will be at the top of the matrix in the RREF form. So the bottom N minus R rows will be zeros. So I will write it this way. So there will be R rows in the top, that is what this IR means, but I have this funny symbol, which is again not a standard symbol. I just use the symbol to mean that there is a matrix with the columns of the identity matrix and some other columns in between. So let me actually show you an example that will make it clearer. So let me show you a full rank example first. I have a system of equations here, the augmented matrix X plus Y plus Z equal to 6, 2x plus 2y plus 1 equal to 9, x plus 3y plus 0z equal to 7. Then I do the REF, I get that, an upper triangular matrix, run a Gauss-Jordan on it, identity matrix here because it's a full rank matrix, and 1, 2, 3, which will be the solution. So this full rank matrix, that became the identity matrix. On the other hand, if the third equation was x plus y equal to 3, which turns out to be not linearly independent of the previous two, my augmented matrix, the first two columns are the same. The last one reads x plus y plus 0z equal to 3. And if I run REF, I get a 0 row down here. And if I run RREF, I can scale the second row by minus 1 to get 1 and 3. And I can use this 1 now to get rid of the value above, just subtract it away. So that becomes 0. And this becomes a 6 minus 3, 3. So this is the RREF. I have a matrix with identity matrix standing here and here, okay, in those two columns. But in between, I have a column which actually corresponds to a free variable. That is what I wrote here, an identity matrix of size the rank, but with some matrix representing the free variables. It's not cleanly separated. Now, if the matrix is tall and full rank, tall means more rows than columns. Tall matrix, full rank means columns are linearly independent. All columns will have pivots, which can be scaled to 1. The pivots can be used to get rid of elements above and below. So what you will have will be an identity matrix, and the M minus R, the extra rows, will all become zeros. So you will have a shape like this. IN standing on top, N is the rank, so it's the same as IR near the top, and everything else below that will be zero. So that's a clean separation of the identity matrix and the zero rows. If it is rank deficient, again, the situation is less than ideal. You will have R columns that are linearly independent, which will give an IR in the top, but not necessarily to the left. It might be again shuffled in with the free variable columns, but the bottom M minus R rows will be zeros. So the shape will have something like this. So here I added one more equation, linearly dependent equation, so that the last row became all zero. So the extra equation I added to the previous set reads x plus 2y plus 3z equal to 14. That is consistent with the rest. So I have an identity matrix. If you just look at this part, which is a coefficient part, I have the identity matrix standing on top with one zero row standing below. If I make sure that the second last equation also is linearly dependent, so these two equations are linearly dependent, so these two rows will become zero rows. That means in the REF, I have only two pivots, so the maximum possible rank was 3, has a rank of 2, so rank deficiency is 1. So if you again look at only that part, I have a minus 1 here, which I scale to make it 1, and then I subtract away from the previous row so that I get 0 there. So I get again only in this part an identity matrix, but in between I have the column corresponding to the free variable. If you have a wide matrix, you have more columns than rows. So if the matrix is a full rank, what's going to happen is that all the rows are linearly independent. All of them will have pivots. There will not be any zero row. So that means there will be an identity matrix of size R, which is the same as the number of rows, M. The rest of the columns, they correspond to free variables. But unfortunately for us, we cannot guarantee that the identity matrix hiding inside the RREF will be to the left. Free variable columns might be in between somewhere, so everything is shuffled in, which is what I mean by this funny symbol. If it is rank deficient, then the rank is going to be less than the number of rows. Then what you will have will be an identity matrix of size R in the first R rows of the RREF. Again, not cleanly separated, but somewhere there. And the rest of the rows will, of course, be zeros, because every linearly dependent row will become zero using the Gaussian elimination steps. So the N minus R columns will correspond to free variables. RREF will have this form whereby you have an identity matrix of size R, the rank, shuffled in with free variable columns, and then you will have M minus R rows that are pivotless rows, those are zero rows, in the bottom. Here I have three variables, so three columns, and two equations, two rows. So if you just look at the coefficient part of it, it's a 2x3 matrix. And if you run RREF on the augmented matrix, first thing you will do is, of course, run REF. So we subtract twice the first row from the second row. You will get that. So 0, 0, minus 1, and minus 3. Then, of course, you have minus 1 here, so you can scale it by minus 1. Pivots are positive 1s now. Now, above the pivot here, there is a 1. You can subtract away the pivot row from the row above to get 0 there. So, of course, augmented side, you will get a 3, the RREF. Again, you can see that there is an identity matrix, 0, 1, 1, 0, hiding there. But in between, you have this free variable column. And if you go to a similar set of equations, now I added one more variable, W. So, what I have now is W plus X plus Y plus Z equal to 6. That's the first equation. And 0W plus 2X plus 2Y plus Z equal to 9. And minus W plus X plus Y plus 0Z equal to 3. Gauss-Jordan elimination. You will try to make this guy 1 by dividing by 2. So that also will become 1. This becomes half. This becomes 9 by 2. And then you'll use that row, subtract away from the previous row. So those ones will go away. But essentially, you're trying to make this 0. But in the process, you got this also to be 0. But that's okay. And then this became a half. And that became some number. So that is the RREF of a wide matrix in which you had some 0 rows. The rank was only 2. As you can see here, in REF, you had only 2 pivots. So the rank was 2. And there is an identity matrix, this time not hiding that well, it's actually right here, of size 2x2, because the rank is 2. 1 zero row, because 1 is a rank deficiency in this case. So summarizing these things, if you have a full rank matrix, if it is square, you get a clean identity matrix. If it is tall matrix, you get identity on top and zero rows below. If it is wide, the clean separation of the identity and the free variable matrices is not guaranteed. If it is rank deficient, there will be free variable columns, which might kind of mess up your identity matrix a little bit. Now, what we are using are all elementary row operations, but we have the freedom to use elementary column operations 2 without affecting the rank, but it actually does affect the solution set. So it's possible to bring all the identity matrix to one corner, to the top left corner, without affecting the rank. Then you will get an identity matrix of size R by R, and that will represent the column rank as well as the row rank. That's why the row rank is the same as the column rank, and that's actually the proof. But you cannot do column operations and expect to have the solution set unchanged.